Hi everyone, my name is Raquel Ortez and I'm the founder and CEO of Wabi. Today I'm going to be talking about adversarial robustness for self-driving. But before I do this, let me tell you the exciting things that we are doing at Wabi. Self-driving is one of the most exciting and important technologies of our generation. Once solved at the scale, it will change the world as we know it. Since the DARPA challenge in 2004, the self-driving industry has made meaningful progress, but commercial deployment is still limited to very simple and small operation domains. The traditional approach to engineering self-driving vehicles results in a software stack that does not take full advantage of the power of AI, and that requires complex and time-consuming manual tuning. This makes scaling costly and technically challenging, especially when it comes to solving the less frequent and more unpredictable driving scenarios. Building off the lessons of the last two decades, Wabi is tackling self-driving in a new way that fully unleashes the power of AI. In particular, our AI-first approach leverages deep learning, probabilistic inference, and complex optimization to create software that is end-to-end trainable, interpretable, and capable of very complex reasoning. This, together with a revolutionary closed-loop simulator that has an unprecedented level of fidelity, enables testing at scale of both common driving scenarios and safety-critical edge cases. This approach significantly reduces the need to drive testing miles in the real world and results in a safer, more affordable solution. Our first use case is long-haul tracking, where there is a chronic shortage of drivers and a need to enhance safety. We are backed up by the best-in-class investors in terms of deep technology, logistics, and the thriving Canadian ecosystem. We launched the company last week, announcing one of the largest Series A in Canadian history. We have offices both in Toronto as well as San Francisco. Come join us, we are hiring. Now, let's get back to the topic of the talk, adversarial robustness for self-driving. As autonomous systems continue to improve, and if you look at the simulation and tests that the self-driving cars or vehicles actually receive, most of them are going to pass. However, is this a measure of how well we are doing? Does the fact that we can solve all the test cases reflect the fact that we are safe to drive in the real world? Not really, right? So we're actually going to need tools to automatically generate worst case or adversarial scenarios that are going to allow us to understand what are the things that we still need to work on and where are the places where our model is actually not robust. And we can potentially use this in order to create much more robust solutions. So let's see how we can do this. Let's start by thinking about how the software stack actually works. First, we perceive the world to identify our surroundings. Next, we perform motion forecasting to understand the actions the actor might take in the future, in the next few seconds. And finally, we use the output of perception and prediction in order to be able to decide what is the safest maneuver to do for the vehicle to actually drive safely and comfortable towards the goal. Now, given the modular nature of the stack, we can test each component separately. For example, we can create challenging examples for the perception model. Similarly, it is also important to create safety-critical scenarios to test the capabilities of the motion planner. And finally, the most holistic way is to test the entire stack end-to-end, starting from the sensor simulation and all the way to the motion planning trajectories. To generate these challenging scenarios, we will leverage adversarial attacks. Now, let's dig deeper into adversarial attacks and their applications in self-driving. First, we will provide some background on adversarial examples. Then we will talk about how they can be applied to different components of the self-driving stack. So let's start with some background. Computer vision has improved dramatically in the past decade thanks to neural networks. Today, image classifiers can even outperform humans in some recognition tasks. However, these neural networks are famous for being vulnerable to adversarial examples. Adding a small and imperceivable amount of noise onto an output, can cause the neural network to fail, even though the perturbation doesn't affect human judgment. While adversarial examples were first introduced for image classification, they have been extended to many other applications, including semantic segmentation, object detection, and natural language processing. How are adversarial examples generated? The main idea is to perturb the clean input minimally while changing the model output. In a white box setting where the model is known and differentiable, we can generate perturbations with gradient-based optimization. Similar to optimizing the weights of a neural network, except that now we are going to fix the weights and optimize the input. In more challenging but practical settings, the model will be unknown or not differentiable. In this case, the attacker can still use black box optimization methods that rely on querying the model. When queries are not available, weaker transfer attacks can be achieved by training a surrogate model to estimate the gradients of the victim model. When it comes to how we want to modify the output, there are two broad categories: targeted and untargeted attacks. Targeted attacks try to induce a specific target output. For example, changing the label from banana to snake. Untargeted attacks do not specify a target output. Anything is fine as long as it's not the correct output. For example, changing the label to anything from the banana label that is the correct. We have seen perturbations against a specific input. However, if the input changes slightly, for example, due to an object moving, for example, the perturbation might not be effective. This makes it difficult to launch attacks in the real world where objects are in motion. Towards more robust attacks for the real world, we can train universal adversaries by training a single perturbation against the entire training set and minimizing the expected accuracy. The result is a perturbation that is input agnostic and can be used to input to attack any input. Furthermore, this will mean that during the attack, we can just use the training adversary without incurring any computational cost. Finally, because we can attack any input, we do not need prior knowledge of the scene to execute an attack. To be threatening in the real world, the adversarial examples should also be physically realizable. This work shows an adversarial sticker, which anyone can print out and stick onto an existing image to fool classifiers. The sticker is universal in that it's adversarial when placed by, you know, with any particular pose and any particular image. Here's another example of a physically realizable attack. The authors here 3D printed a mesh of a turtle, but pictures of the turtle are basically classified as a rifle or other classes. This object is universal in that it can pull classifiers when seen from any viewpoint. We've seen that practical real-world adversarial attacks against neural networks are possible. On the one hand, self-driving vehicles rely heavily on neural networks, and self-driving is a highly safety-critical application. Therefore, it's important that we study adversarial robustness in self-driving. All right, so let's move into adversarial attacks in self-driving, starting with attacks on the perception model. 3D object detection is the first part of the autonomy stack. Successfully disrupting perception can be detrimental as perception features failures will propagate to downstream tasks. What are we looking for when we design this type of attack? Well, first, the adversary has to be physically realizable to be a real-world threat. Second, the adversary should be robust to motion as everything is moving relative to the ego vehicle. Third, the adversary should hide objects as colliding to unseen objects is the most dangerous outcome. Finally, the attack should not require too much computation during execution. So let's look at existing adversarial attacks against modern 3D object detectors. We will focus on point cloud inputs as LiDAR sensors are the most popular sensing hardware in self-driving vehicles. Adversarial attacks on point clouds are slightly different from images, as one can move points, add points, and remove points. Whereas in images, the only thing that we can do is modify the pixels. However, arbitrary modification of these points are often not physically realizable, as point clouds are often generated by sensors with fixed angular frequencies, like a LiDAR. Thus, some works try to modify points as if they were as if they were coming from an underlying surface. But how do we actually modify the point cloud readings from sensors? Some works have used a spoofing device to send the LiDAR sensor false signals and create adversarial points. This can cause perception to hallucinate false positives. It's possible to launch efficient black box attacks by collecting false positive examples from existing datasets or simulations. Then, instead of performing optimization, the attacker directly places these examples into the scene. Spoofing devices may be difficult to execute in practice as the LiDAR sensor moves. A more reliable way to generate adversarial point clouds is to place an adversarial object into the scene. In this work, a physically realizable adversarial mesh generates a point cloud which creates false positives. Previous works mostly focus on false positives. However, false negatives and colliding into unseen objects may be much more dangerous. So let's see what we can do. In the work that we're going to show now, we present a method to hide other vehicles on the road. To make the attack physically realizable, we parameterize the adversary as a 3D printable mesh. The mesh is placed on vehicle rooftops for several reasons. It's easier to place due to gravity, it's less prone to occlusion, and it resembles realistic rooftop cargos like furniture and sport equipment that we might see in the real world. Finally, we aim to make the adversary universal, hiding vehicles across time and space with high confidence, and making the adversary robust to other variations of the environment. By placing our adversarial mesh on a vehicle roof, we can hide the vehicle with high probability, no matter what kind of car it is, what the pose is of this vehicle, and what the environment is. Note that our mesh is the same for all vehicles. As shown in the illustration here, the same adversarial mesh successfully hides for different vehicles at different positions in different scenes. Furthermore, with a single universal adversary for all inputs, no optimization is required during the attack, and therefore it's a very efficient attack. We thus train to discover a single mesh that is an adversary against all vehicles in the training set. This makes the adversary input agnostic under the training distribution. Towards this goal, we use a differentiable renderer to bridge the gap between the mesh representing the physical object and what the sensors see, which is a point cloud, and optimize an adversarial objective targeted at minimizing detection scores to hide the vehicles. In particular, to minimize detection scores, our adversarial loss minimizes the confidence of all bounding box proposals. In addition, we weigh proposals by the intersection of our union with the ground truth to prioritize attacking high quality proposals. We mainly rely on black box optimization in order to be applicable to all models. Even when gradients are available, we find that white box attacks have similar strength, since black box optimization works well in this low dimensional mesh representation. Let's see an illustration of how our algorithm works. We first start with a LiDAR strip, which is the input to our detection. Then we aim to hide a vehicle from the detector. To do this, we add a physically realizable object into the scene. Here we choose a mesh as our representation, as it can be 3D printed. Then we use a differentiable renderer to render the mesh into a point cloud and attack it from the top of the vehicle. To determine the location of the roof, we fit a mesh to the point cloud. We then add the mesh from point cloud into the vehicle rooftop to create the modified scene. This modified SIN is then processed by a detector to produce output bounding boxes. To optimize the adversary, we train the adversarial loss to be targeted at hiding the vehicles. Let's look at some quantitative demonstration of the attacks. The same adversarial mesh is used throughout the whole video. Notice in the top right, in the original snippet, the target vehicle is consistently detected. However, on the bottom right, after adding the adversary, the vehicle is hidden in most frames. Therefore, the attack is successful. We evaluate our attacks against models with different input representations. We use Pixel, which takes occupancy voxels as a variation, and a variation of Pixel taking density voxels. We also use PointRCNN, which processes raw point sets, and point pillars, which divides points into pillars and extracts features using a point net. We're going to evaluate the attack here on Kitty. Our metric is attack success rate, which is the percentage of originally detected vehicles that are not detected after perturbation. We also include transfer attacks, where we train the mesh to attack one detector and evaluate it against another detector. In this table, rows describe the model using training, and columns are models during evaluation. Thus, the diagonal represents standard attacks. Our results show that different input representations have different levels of vulnerability. Of the diagonals are transfer attacks. We observe a high degree of transferability between models with the same architecture, as is the case of the two pixel variants. We observe low transferability elsewhere, indicating input representations might have a large effect on the features a model learns and the vulnerabilities of these particular features. To verify that the input representations indeed impact robustness, we conduct an experiment where we replace Pixel's occupancy voxel representation with the pillar feature encodings. We are able to use the same backbone and training scheme since both Pixel and point pillars perform two deconvolutions in per se. Here, Pixel star is significantly more robust, purely due to the different input representation. This suggests that additional point level features before aggregating in the high dimension increases robustness to rooftop objects. We compare white box against black box optimization and find that black box optimization is not much weaker. Furthermore, we benchmark against the mesh that is used for initialization of our adversarial attack. Although the initial mesh is similar in size, it has little impact on detection recoil. On the other hand, the adversarial mesh drops recoil significantly, showing that the geometry is indeed adversarial. Even without malicious intent, these scenarios can coincidentally occur in practice in the form of rooftop cargo. We conduct experiments where we initialize the mesh from common rooftop objects and additionally place an epsilon constraint on mesh vertices to maintain resemblance to the original mesh. We measure attack success rate against, again as before, right? And find adversaries that are very similar to real-world furniture and sports equipment. Particularly, we find larger objects like couches and canoes to be especially effective. The smaller and thinner objects like chairs and bikes are weaker as they generate less ladder points. We also conduct a pilot study on defense with two approaches. First, we perform data augmentation by adding random meshes to vehicle rooftops during training. By training against random rooftop objects, we can generate and greatly improve the robustness, as you can see here. Next, we use adversarial training, which adds adversarial meshes into the scene during training. Here we simultaneously update the adversarial mesh and the model. Furthermore, we also show detection performance on the unperturbed dataset in the rightmost column and show that a defended model achieves similar or better performance. Thus, by training against our adversaries, models become more robust in auto-distribution, but they are not going to leave out the performance that they have originally. Our work is a step towards safer self-driving under unseen conditions from limited training data. Now, in addition to LiDAR sensors, which are commonly used for because they have great ability to capture rich 3D representations, Other sensory inputs are typically used in self-driving, for example, cameras. Therefore, we want to extend this work to consider adversarial attacks on multimodal perception systems. And images are interesting, and in particular, they have found to be very, very vulnerable to adversarial attacks when processing in isolation. So we are interested in looking into what happens when we have multiple input modalities. There exist some works which paint vehicles to create adversarial textures. As a result, the vehicles are camouflaged and hidden from image detectors. However, this attack does not target multimodal detectors. In the work shown in the slide, the authors perturb both image and data to study how image features affect robustness and find that image perturbations are much more effective than data. However, the attack perturbs images and data independently, which results in perturbations which are inconsistent across the two modalities, which means that they cannot really exist in practice. To hide vehicles in a realistic manner, we extend the previous roof of cargo attack that we were talking about to include a texture mesh. And we're going to render the same object into the two modalities, LiDAR as well as cameras, to ensure that perturbations are physically realizable. All right, so we're going to start by extending the LiDAR simulation pipeline to accommodate images as well. So here we have a LiDAR sweep and an input image. The host vehicle is highlighted in green in the LiDAR and clearly visible in the image. So again, we're going to perturb the mesh and we're going to fit this mesh to approximate the pose of the host vehicle, which represents the pose of the adversary. To handle the occlusion in images, we also need to know the depth of each individual pixel, which is not available in the raw data. So we're going to use a depth completion network, which takes the image of interest and spark ground truth LiDAR measurements to obtain a dense estimate of every pixel's depth. Then we're going to render the adversary and place it into the scene and discard occluded pixels or LiDAR point clouds by simply removing points or pixels with greater depth along the same grid. Finally, we apply a single very simple directional lighting model to approximate sunlight and enhance the realism of our simulation. We then extend the previous work to incorporate the image simulation module, and we are going to replace the LiDAR-only model with one that actually takes as input both images as well as LiDAR. In addition to what we were doing before, we're going to introduce a false positive component into the loss function, which is going to encourage high confidence in all proposals which do not overlap with any ground truth boxes. We perform the attack on two datasets, Kitty and an internal dataset which we call SIMMET. We evaluate the success rate of false positives and false negatives and false positives separately in our metrics. To attack a single modality, we disable the gradient flow to the other modality during the bubble pass. And our experiments are all conducted on the MMF model, which is a state-of-the-art model that fuses image and data information to create very accurate 3D object detections. Now, our model to generate these adversarial perturbations is general and can work with any differentiable model. We perform attacks on a LiDAR-only detector and a detector which uses both LiDAR and images. Overall, we find that multimodal models are slightly more vulnerable to the LiDAR-only counterpart, which might seem counterintuitive. For the multimodal model, we experiment with three settings: attacking LiDAR, attacking images, or attacking both of them. In addition, we consider a baseline of a mesh with randomly generated geometry and texture. We find that successful attacks on image LiDAR models are mostly caused by brittle image features. Note that perturbing LiDAR alone is not very effective, and on the other hand, perturbing image alone is almost as effective as perturbing both. We also conduct black box transfer attacks between the two different data sets, which are captured with different sensor hardware configurations like image resolution and LiDAR calibration. Furthermore, these data sets are captured at different geographic locations, Europe versus North America. We observe a small degree of transferability between the two data sets, as the attack success rate after transfer is much higher than using a random mesh. Here's a demonstration of our attack on Kitty. While both data and image are perturbed, we only show the image here as it's easier to see the host vehicle. Notice the flickering of the detections after perturbation. In contrast, the unperturbed vehicle on the top is consistently detected in every frame. Now let's look at some qualitative examples of false positives. We mostly observe them in distant locations far away from the host vehicle. We show that these false positives in the first eye view radar sweeps, since they are too small to see in the image. Upon visualization, the image features after perturbation, we can see the adversary induces a strong adversarial features in the image space. These strong features are then projected into 3D, and after projection, they dominate the 3D radar features after fusion and create false positives. Finally, we explore several dense methods against our attack. First, we employ JPEG compression and the compression on the image inputs, and find that this has very little effect. Next, we find adversarial and training to be very effective. Furthermore, by combining feature denoising with adversarial training, we can achieve a very strong defense against false negatives, but the effect of false positives is much weaker. We suspect that this is because false positives are also caused by inaccurate associations between 2D pixels and 3D data points in fusion, and such inaccuracies cannot be corrected through adversarial defenses. Now, after we see how adversarial attacks can be actually very detrimental for perception systems, both single modality and multiple modality, now let's go into how we can attack methods that exploit vehicle-to-vehicle communication. When we study adversarial robustness at the sensor input level, how about during this vehicle-to-vehicle communication? Right? If you look at how Stellarine is going to look in the future, we're going to have many vehicles in the scene, and they can communicate, and potentially this has the power to actually do much better perception. First, let's look at a refresher of a state-of-the-art network that performs vehicle-to-vehicle communication that we're going to attack. So the way that V2B net works is the following. Here we have three different vehicles in the scene. And every vehicle is going to collect input representation depicted here with the radar. Then the sensory inputs are going to be processed to create intermediate representations. Then we're going to generate messages which are actually compressed and sent to the medium. The receiving vehicle is going to decompress these messages and it's going to process them with a specially aware GNN that takes into account also the difference of receiving time in order to create very accurate predictions, perception and prediction outputs, where prediction here is the motion forecasting of where the actors will be into the future. Okay, so this is a network that actually works extremely well. It can improve performance in perception and prediction by a very, very large margin. Now, as we've seen, the V2B with this V2B communication can really boost the performance drastically. However, it also can open the door to vulnerabilities. An attacker can potentially start tempering the messages. And the question is this actually dangerous? Communication channels can be compromised to inject adversarial messages. While existing security protocols can provide adequate security for communication, additional levels of redundancy are always welcome, especially in safety-critical applications such as self-driving. Thus, we study adversarial attacks to improve robustness of communication systems at the neural network level. Adversarial messages can severely degrade performance. By setting small epsilon constraints on the perturbations, the adversarial messages are almost indistinguishable from the original, making it very difficult to detect that we've been attacked. So we next are going to study how to create these perturbations that are added on top of messages, which are intermediate network representations, that mimic basically what P2P net was actually transmitting. So again, we're going to attack object detection, where detectors are going to output proposals, each with a bounding box, a class, and a confidence score. In this work, we're going to, another set of message is crafted to attack all detectors in the scene instead of just the host vehicle. We can attack the output by changing the class label of these proposals. We can generate false negatives by changing classes of detected objects to the background class to make objects disappear. On the other hand, false positives can be generated by changing background classes to an object class to make the detection model hallucinate that they exist indeed an object when it's not the case. In a white box setting, attackers can easily create adversarial messages using gradient-based updates to generate false class labels. However, full access to the model running in the SDV is not practical. This is not going to happen typically. In a scenario where communication channels are compromised, attackers can still execute adversarial human-in-the-loop attacks without access to the gradients. Here, the attacker can only eavesdrop on the communication channel and does not have access to sensory measurements of the vehicles. To do so, the attacker needs to train a surrogate model to approximate the gradients of the target model. By doing so, perturbations generated by the surrogate model will transfer to intermediate features of the target model. However, this requires that the surrogate produces similar intermediate representations. While the attacker cannot access the target model, the intermediate features of the target model are available by spying on the communication channel. Thus, when training the surrogate model, we use a discriminator to match the distribution of the surrogate's intermediate features to those of the target model. When we use a discriminator instead of distillation, since the communication channel does not contain the sensory inputs, which are associated with each message, and thus we don't have pair data to do distillation. In addition, the surrogate model is also trained to perform the same perception task to imitate the behavior of the target model. Once the surrogate model is trained, we can execute attacks by using gradient-based updates to generate a transferable perturbation using the surrogate model and adding it onto the benign message. In contrast to universal attack shown previously, where computation is not really required during the attack because we have a physical object, performing optimization in every time step of an online attack, as we need to do here, is extremely expensive. So we need to find a solution to do the attack in a more realistic manner, in a way that it can be done in a very efficient manner as well. So in a normalized setting, we can exploit the redundancy between consecutive frames to create more efficient attacks. Specifically, we can use the perturbation from a previous frame as initialization from the current frame. In addition, we apply a regular transformation at every time step to take into account the fact that the ego vehicle has moved. By doing so, we can synchronize the perturbations with the movement of sensory measurements relatively to the ego car. So here we plot the average precision at different numbers of agents. We show a no attack baseline and a noise baseline where random uniform noise with the same bound is added. Our white box attack is able to drop AP significantly at very few agents, but the model becomes more robust with more agents. Our transfer attack is able to achieve a small degree of success, but as expected, is much weaker than the white box attack. Here we show the benign feature map in the top left and the perturbation on its right. The perturbation is very small, as can be seen from the color scheme. On the bottom left, the unperturbed messages produce mostly correct detections. After adding the perturbation, see all the false positives and false negatives that we observe on the bottom right. So we definitely are able to create safety critical issues for fleet of self-driving vehicles by using this technique. Here we demonstrate the necessity of using domain adaptation to align intermediate representations of the surrogate model. We compare generating perturbations with three models, the original model, a surrogate model with domain adaptation, and a surrogate without. We evaluate in a setting with only two SDBs in the network. First, using the original model to generate perturbations is equivalent to a white box attack and is very strong. Then notice that the attack is completely ineffective without domain adaptation. Next, we evaluate the cross-inference, which is using the surrogate model to process the intermediate features of the target model, which evaluates how well the surrogate imitates the target. We can see that domain adaptation makes a drastic difference here, and is therefore necessary. Here is a qualitative demonstration of the domain adaptation. We show four channels of the intermediate feature maps. Notice the similarity between the target model and the surrogate with domain adaptation. But without domain adaptation, the features look very, very different. We conduct an ablation on our method to perform efficient online attacks. In the not working baseline, we do not perform rigid transformations to account for ego motion, which results in a slightly weaker attack. In the independent setting, we ignore temporal redundancy and treat each frame as independent, thus not reusing previous perturbations. The attack becomes significantly weaker. All right, so we have shown how to build robust autonomous systems on perception and communication, right, and how to attack these systems as well. We're going to turn our attention now to study how to generate the scenarios that might cause failures for the entire server stack. Robust perception are not the end, since there is a need for looking at whether there is particular behaviors that are actually adversarial that might cause failures of the entire software stack. As self-driving vehicles perform better in natural and well-behaved scenarios, this becomes very, very important because it's very, very difficult to actually understand where our failures are. Right, so identifying the challenges is you know, can be very challenging, can be actually, you know, typically we're gonna require exponentially many combinations of the scenarios in order to find where potentially we have a failure. Right, so let's look at whether we can use adversarial techniques to identify such potential failures. Conventional practice in industry for comprehensive testing is a semi-automatic process that relies on human expertise to create an initial scenario set, where each scenario contains at most one or two actors of interest with the specific initial locations and trajectories. Scenario variations are then programmatically created by varying the actors' locations and velocity profiles. While such scenarios are valuable, they only evaluate simple interactions with the SDV and do not test complex multi-actor interactions, such as lane margins and unprotected left turns in dense traffic scenarios or scenes. Furthermore, human involvement makes this process time-consuming and difficult to scale. Manual design may also result in missing testing configurations that might actually prevent us from identifying failure modes of the system. So to address this problem, recent works aim to automate the generation process by searching over the space of all possible scenarios and identifying high-risk ones according to a specific cost map. Note that we also want the scenarios to be physically plausible, for example, if an adversary is really trying to chase the SDV and trying to hit it, it's not necessarily something we're going to see very often. The rightmost figure here is going to show a reasonably high-cost scenario. For simplicity, most previous works only consider a motion planning model that has access to the ground truth state of the actors in the scene. In this way, they only need to focus on modeling dangerous actor behaviors. Moreover, it is fast to generate and evaluate the scenario since the perception system is basically omitted. This overlooks the fact that many adversarial scenarios often involve actors that are hard to identify due to occlusion or have trajectory plans that can be very, you know, difficult to localize and forecast. Such issues in the perception and motion forecasting models can generate compounding errors that ultimately are going to cause the entire system to fail. To mitigate this issue, some other works that's end-to-end image-based self-driving systems. However, the adversary scenarios here they generate are either generated at a small scale or with respect to simplified imitation learning models that do not reflect the autonomous systems that are used in modern self-driving vehicles in the industry. Additionally, they usually modify high-level actor behaviors or create physically unrealizable trajectories, which lacks fine-grained control in modeling the actor behavior. Therefore, there is a need for a scalable approach to identify physically plausible challenging scenarios starting from sensor data for modern autonomous systems. Starting from the latter data matters since it allows, is going to allow us to conduct end-to-end testing and training with those simulated scenarios. This table provides a summary of recent works. Most player works generate scenarios only for a handful of scene configurations and are adversarial only with respect to a planning model that takes ground truth actors as input. We propose a scalable approach to modify existing traffic scenarios to cause full autonomy failures. Our approach tests the full autonomy system and generates over 4,000 unique adversarial scenarios. We frame the generation process as a worst case scenarios as a black box adversarial attack. We call our system adversarial scene, and it works as follows. Given an existing scenario and its original sensor data, we're going to perturb the actor's trajectory in a physically plausible manner. Next, we're going to update the sensor data to take the actor perturbation into account. We then are going to evaluate the autonomous system on the modifier scenario, compute an adversarial objective, and update the proposed perturbation using a black box search algorithm. An adversarial scene works for any ladder-based autonomy stack. It doesn't need to be differentiable or anything like this. Adversarial scene's goal is to increase the risk of the autonomous system tau star to actually do the wrong thing. Our adversarial objective consists of an imitation loss representing the deviation from the expert trajectory, a safety cost to encourage collisions with other actors, and traffic loop violations and comfort costs that encourage the autonomy plan to have lane violations and be dangerous. To ensure the realism of simulated behaviors, we parameterize the active behavior with a bicycle model and set physical constraints such as staying on the road and not colliding with other actors. Given the perturbations on the actor emotions, we conduct realistic ladder simulation to accurately reflect the updated scene. The modified ladder history in the new input is a new input to the autonomy system. The video here shows that the generated scenes are realistic and match desired perturbations. We now show adversarial scene generated scenarios from the P3 autonomy system. We focus on an open loop scenario evaluation setting. Or an open loop scenario evaluation setting in which the evaluated autonomy system takes the past 1 second of the ladder data as input, and it's going to output 5 seconds of the trajectory plan. We're going to then unroll the 5 seconds of our plan and the other actors' trajectories for these 5 seconds as well, and evaluate the autonomy system performance during the time horizon in an open loop setting. The SDV is in blue and the perturbed actors are highlighted in red.
And a crossing pedestrian. In the 5 second trajectory output from the P3 system, the SDV only moves forward a little. Adversin perturbs the initial states of the bus in red by moving it into the left lane. Now, the P3 autonomy system does not detect the pedestrian, and the SDV's 5 second plan collides with it. To understand why the SDV behaves as it does, we now show the forecasted occupancy visualizations of the P3 autonomy system. The occupancy for pedestrians is shown in light green. As we can see, the pedestrian is perceived as part of the bus's occupancy area, and hence the system misses the pedestrian detection. Here's another example. Originally, the blue STD lane changes smoothly to avoid the stationary bus in front. Adversum perturbs the bus to instead be reversing and blocking the road. Now, when the STD attempts to lane change, it is rear-ended by a high-speed vehicle from behind. From the occupancy visualization, we can see the predicted bus occupancy blocks the whole lane. This causes the STD to predict a dangerous large turn to avoid the bus, but does not properly account for traffic from behind.
So regressing generates challenging scenarios for a wide range of state-of-the-art autonomous systems. As we can see, they initially achieve a relatively low collision rate on natural real-world scenarios. We have limitation learning, you know, motion planner, PLG, as well as P50. But with adversarial sim, we increase the collision rate by over 200% compared to the original set. These challenging and physically plausible scenarios provide insights into how different autonomous systems compare and how they fail. Adversarial sim scenarios can also be used in autonomous systems trained to improve performance. We take here two pre-trained SOTA models, PLT and P3, and fine-tune them on a dataset augmented with adversarial sim scenarios. Robust training with adversarial sim generated decisions helps improve the performance in both the original and adversarial scenarios, making the autonomous system much safer. So this is a great way to be able to generate adversarial scenarios and be able to incorporate extra robustness in any autonomous systems. So to conclude, we touch upon how to generate adversarials to identify vulnerabilities in the context of perception, vehicle-to-vehicle communication, and the full autonomous system. We then show how we can use these adversaries to improve the robustness of current self-driving systems. This is all for me today. Thank you very much for listening.